Hey everybody, this is your brother, Narada, Michael Walden. Welcome to All In, my podcast where we break down music, life, and love, interviews, and conversations. Let's get into it. Ladies and gentlemen, we welcome Little Anthony.
Hi. The man. Dude, I've been wanting to meet you.
I know. Wow. I'm such a huge fan. Anthony, you don't understand. From my side, your passion and love of music and the way that you're able to sing it touched me and has moved me and inspired me in my production, in my work with the Whitneys and the Arethas and everybody else, because I heard how to do it through you. I have to just tell you that, man.
But that's how I have to tell you that. You know, when you've been this long, I've been in this business, man. I've had people ask me, oh, how do you do that? You're 83 and I go, it's not natural. It's supernatural.
Yes.
The godly gift, because I know many of my contemporaries, man, the singers can sing rings around me, but their lives either disrupted whatever they were doing. And I'm not saying that because I lived this very godly life. No, but I understand where it comes from. And because of that, I take it quite seriously. And then plus, I study a lot, man, you know. I mean, it goes back to my dad, back to when he was a musician. And my mom was a gospel singer, by the way. You know, we call the Nazareth Baptist gospel singers. So music has always been in my life. And I really would hear people like Ella Fitzgerald and Nat Cole. And up to that point, that was what was influencing me as a child of, you know, 8, 9 years old. Yes. Then one day, I'm like, 15? Yeah. And I'm walking down the street. There's something in Fort Greene in Brooklyn. And in those days, people would play their music loud. You know, in the summertime, they'd open their windows in the project. Yes. And I hear this voice coming out saying, why do fools fall in love?
Yes.
Why do fools fall in love? And my mother make a day. And I said, whoa! started to consume everything he was doing. And those kind of influences came into my life. I began to try to evaluate, well, can I sing like that? Mm-hmm. Until I ended up starting to listen to people like Sinatra and his phrasing and all these people. So there's always it's a collaboration, a combination of many parts of me.
Yes.
The person.
Yes.
The acting part, people don't realize I was an actor, child actor before I was even known as a little Anthony.
Wow, okay.
So all those things come into play. And then as I developed, I learned that I'm not going to be able to be a 17-year-old little Anthony. You know, I got to find, what do I do? I start learning breathing and this and that, and I would listen and just consume other singers like Bennett and all these kind of people, and then try to emulate them the way they were breathing. And, you know, by the way, Nada, I was an opera singer that I met one day.
Yeah.
And he heard me warming up.
Yeah.
He said, what are you doing? You're ruining your voice.
Whoa.
You know, one of those cats. And I'm going, I don't know, I'm warming up. I don't know where I was. He was there at the theater somewhere. And he said, no. We must always sing on the low tonation of oneself. And I go, huh? But in fact, he was totally right. Hmm. So he was saying, how you warm up is very, very important to what's going to happen to you the rest of the day singing. And so he taught me to always do notes like try to get as low and then gradually, move up step by step. And I made up this sort of thing, and I got to become a habit. And now I'm looking back in retrospect, in hindsight being 2020, that guy was right.
Wow.
Okay. Because you could do some damage to these boys. When I listen to people like Whitney Houston and all of the greats, I can tell the gift they have, which makes them have that it. And they just know who they are when they express themselves as singing, and then they back it up because they got the chops to do it. I've learned that I can't try to out sing or go as high as anybody else can go and all this stuff. That's very impressive. I think one of the Imperials, Sammy Strang, told me one day it's called vocal gymnastics. He said, "Oh man, that it's cool." He said to me, "I've known you a long time, man." He said, "There's something when you just be you. Just be you." And so when you put all that stuff together, what you learn and all that developed. And what happened, I transitioned from one thing to another thing to another thing. And before I knew it, I was in three different decades.
Wow.
See? And all the way up to now.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Days. Yes.
Now, I did a recording not long ago that Michael Franklin, a producer, young producer, was and me. He told me, "Oh man, you can do it. You can hit that high C and sustain." I said, "Nah." I said, "I can hit a high C, but I don't live there no more. I just visited."
Okay.
And so he did something with technology today that blew my mind. He just did it. Let's do it line by line, so that you can get a hold of it and you don't have to force it. And I was quite startled that I was hitting the same, but the same intensity when given the opportunity at my age to rest or like think about it to the next, And so I've been very blessed in that respect. So I thank you that you said that to me. Because it triggers me. It makes me want to say it so other singers can hear and learn from it. It's true. Smokey Robinson says the same thing not long ago. He said, "I know cats in the hood, in the neighborhood, that can out-sing me. And I believe in there's so many people can. But one of the things that I've learned is what Frank Sinatra always knew. And that is the essence of what the song is saying, what are the writers trying to explain? And then we really interpret what he physically, by voices, what he's trying to convey to people in his writing. It doesn't mean necessarily he wants everything verbatim, like, no. But when he wrote that song, he wrote it for a reason. And his lyric, he had a view in his mind what that song meant. And so it's our job to try to give him something that he's looking for, the yes. color he's looking for, or she yes. is yes. looking for.
Yes. Yes. I think that on our hand, we can only count a few great ones, and you're that. Because you possess the magic. You call it it's like supernatural magic.
Yeah.
When you sing, you get lost in this magic that we witness. And this is what touches me. Even since I was like 12 years old, I could see that and feel that in you. And you're the first, quite frankly, even before the Dionne Warwick and all that other stuff come on the scene, when I was a little kid, it hurt so bad going out of my head, the drama of those songs, shagaga, and then so soft now, going back in with power again. And then how you could then on the endings have such control of the highs that you do, your riffs. You're the first to me. I love Smokey Robinson. I love everybody. But you're the first to me that really had the fire, that brought something fresh to the music that we had never heard before.
Ooh.
I have to tell you that. Because, and it's actually from that I draw. When I sound to do like, Where Do Broken Hearts Go for Whitney Houston? How are we going to peak it? I know that if I look into your records and look to what you do, there's information that we use to this day because of your fire and magic that's your God gift. And I have to just make sure I tell you that.
Thank you. I had a lot of our contemporary, Kenny, said to me one day in the studio, he said, "You don't know who you are, huh?" Mm-hmm. I don't know. He said, "No, you." He said, "Maybe that's the thing that you have. You really don't. You don't dwell on what it is. You're more interested in getting that the song to come to life." And he said, "Cause I can tell when you came out of the studio." He said, "Look, I was listening about so many takes, and I was throwing all these things at you, and I start to see you looking weary, and like, and when you did that last take, I said he gave me everything he had, and I knew." And Teddy says, "I knew it. That was it. Are you gonna get? It was gonna go any further." He understood that. That's one of the things that I like about him. But he looked at me coming through the hallway, and he says, "Man, you look like you gave it this. You like weary." I mean, like I said, Kenny, I sure did.
Mm-hmm. Well, we're speaking of the same song, "Time on My Hands."
Yes, sir.
This song is so beautiful. I'm so honored to be part of it with you.
I am so honored that you were on it when he called me to say that. The people that were performing said you and that you're like a legend to us. I heard all about you, and I said, "Dang,
yes.
Whoa, really? Yeah, yes. He's gonna play on it."
Yes.
I said, "Whoa, you know, it's really the me. It's the journey that takes me, turns me on. It's not the goal." Mm-hmm. I don't want to get deep with people because we're all going to die. There's no really goal, but the trip itself is really where all the fun is. Because you know, when you get to the goal, then you ain't got nowhere else to go.
right.
So thank you, man. For
God bless you, brother. Let me ask you, how did you feel at being 16 years old around that time of your life? The tears on my pillow and the success new in your life. And now you're on Dick Clark, and now you're like really being exposed.
Yeah.
How did that hit you?
I can't speak for the other guys.
Yeah.
But for me, I sort of got a sense something was going on by the people that were producing it, like George Golda of Alien Garden Records, who was the president, Richard Barrett, who was the A&R man of those songs, Tears in My Pillow and Shimmy Shimmy Cocoa Bop. The way they were acting, and even the flash forward, Don Costa and Teddy Randazzo, you know, Don Costa was Sinatra's guy.
Right.
There's something when I would be singing, and again, maybe that's what Kenny caught. I just was tired, like I ran a marathon or something. Yeah, I guess I was concentrating so hard, trying to find that inner thing of that song. I've seen most of them will be in the booth or something, and then they'll do this. There's always some kind of what, something like that. Mm-hmm. And I would look and go, well, maybe this was the take.
Yes. Yes.
And so I really fed off them. They let me know. Maybe that's why Kenny said to me, "You don't know who you are." Mm-hmm. And I don't. I don't look at it that way. I look at it as the greatest fun. At 83, man, I'm just as excited about recording as I was when I was 23. There's no difference. I go in that room and I go, dang, it's fun, you know? I don't know how I'm going to really sound. Is this chops ready tonight? Or are they going to give me what I need? Or do I have to go, oh, no, come back another day, you know? I have all those thoughts that most singers have in the studio.
Yes.
But I can truthfully say that 98% of the time, it was there in some form or another. And like I said, I fed off other people to see a Tom Bell do the same thing as George Golan and Don Costa and whoa, like they, it's what I've learned now that I enjoy. And I
Yes.
saw even in this recording because I felt, oh, now this is going somewhere I never really played with, you know what I'm saying? And I just kind of look, and I'm always looking in the booth, and I would see Kenny's so intense, and he's like, you know, bobbing his head, oh, he's doing something. And last when he looked at me, he went, see you outside. He's like,
For those who don't know, we're speaking of the great Kenny Burke
Kenny
from
Burke.
the Five Stair Steps,
Yes.
and what a genius group the Five Stair Steps
Yeah, man,
were
I
with
studied
Curtis
them
Mayfield and all that out of
all in cat.
Chicago. But Kenny loves you like I do. Kenny was blessed to be able to see you live. I never saw you live at that time. We
Yeah,
heard you, but
he
he
told
saw
me.
you and
Yeah.
knew the power that was coming off of you.
He said his dad, the greatest influence over the kids, all his but siblings, to sing and perform. And he said, took him to the Regal in
Yes, the
Chicago.
Regal Theater, Chicago. Yes.
Yeah. And that's where I met a lot of people. Curtis Mayfield. That's another story. Anyway. Curtis said, man, we need to write a song, dude.
Yeah, that's
I
right.
don't know. That's the stupidest move I ever made in my life. I could have been a co-writer with this guy.
All right.
But he wanted to do that. But that's another story. But Kenny's dad used to take him to the Regal. He saw me there several times. And he was, as a kid, he was like, whoa.
That's right.
I had the Will Phonak of the Delphonics, one of the survivors of that. And he said to me, he said, man, we both got an award or something in Atlantic City. And he said, you don't know, man, my brother, we used to sit there and listen to you, man, and say, how's he do that? And so he said, you notice all the cats out of Philly that came out of the Gambling Huff stable? They're all trying to do falsetto. Do it. You know, Russell Thompson. He said it was you, man. You were the Philly model of what you're doing. I said, I wasn't doing it that much. I mean, I did two people in the world because I didn't know what else to do. Simple as that. It was a group lead. The chorus was the group. Actually, they were doing the verses, and I had nothing to do. I just remember the song I heard. I think it was by the. Oh, I can't remember the one of the Paragons. What was in those days? Anyway, they did a song called Closer You Are. And it would go, the closer you are. And this guy was doing all that stuff. And I gotta do something. So I just started making up where the melody was going. I just followed the melody and did that. Well, it affected a lot of kids in Philadelphia.
Yes, brother.
Because even a Gamble, Kenny Gamble, told me, he said, no, he said, you were the key to that. And I'm going, what was I doing? I was just singing, you know? He said, no, whatever it was, everybody latched on to that. So if you're talking about the Philly sound, that was the person that they developed and I wanted to sound like, or get at least get the tonations I was doing and stuff. And so I said, wow, man, I didn't know that, you know. Who
Yeah, okay, who knew? Well, I have to just go back for just a little bit earlier period, if you don't mind,
Yeah, go.
to your work with Teddy Randazzo.
Oh, yeah,
Which
baby.
is incredible. Even to this
Incredible.
day, it is still so incredible and monumental.
Oh,
Of the Hurt
man.
So Bad is so beautiful to this day. And don't forget, going out of my head, that period is just so profound to all musicians, all producers, all writers, all arrangers. It just has to
Yeah.
be said to you. I mean, so anything you want to say about that, we're all
Well, one
ears.
thing I was doing, I talked to Shelly, Teddy's widow, and I said, I'll do everything I can to get that man in the Hall of Fame, because he wrote not only just hits for me, he wrote for Steve Lawrence, he wrote for just about it, Sinatra. The guys like that, when I got there, actually, you got a couple of days. It's like me. It's like, whoa, there's something going on. I can't really. It was at my a guy by the name of Ernie Martinelli was managing us at the time, and he's working on Broadway between 52nd, 53rd, 4th, or something. And he ran into Teddy. Well, I knew Teddy before he knew him. I met Teddy back when I was with a little local singing group called the DuPonts.
Okay.
And we had a little regional hit called Prove It Tonight, and we ended up opening at Alan Freed's, for the Alan Freed's spectacular shows in New York at the New York Paramount. And Teddy's room was next to mine. So we only did one song to open. If you love me, really love me, prove it tonight. And that was all we did. Then the greats came out. Frank Lyman, Teenagers, The Platters, wow. Nappy Brown, Joanne Camp, you know, just on and on and on, all the big hit stars at that time. We were just the opening act. Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, like people. But Teddy, I used to always look in the wings, and there was Teddy. Just looking. And he told me later, he said, you know what? Every time you go out there, you would go out there, and that one song, and I never knew you. He said, you would give it another twist or something each time you would go out. Mm-hmm. And he said, that's unusual. And it was very intriguing to him.
Mm-hmm.
And he said to me, kid, he said, one day we're going to work together.
Okay.
That was 1956.
Okay.
And then fast forward to 64, we did. that relationship was so unique. That doesn't come along very much. It's a lot like Dionne Warwick and
Burt Bacharach
and Hal David.
Hal David. Yes, exactly.
And Stan Applebaum with the Drifters.
Yes.
The combination of these two people make for something very special in the creative mm-hmm. process. And I didn't, you know, he said, I was fooling around with Don Costa, and he was the boss of DCP Productions. And he called Don, come in the room, because he had a little upright piano against the wall. And he says, Don, listen to this. Now, we're sending live. This is not the day you're sending it to the demo from the floor. No, in those days, you actually went to the office and you would sing a cappella. And anyway, he's playing, and I got enough of the song, and that song was Outside Looking In.
Yes.
And so he was playing a little, I guess, a little piano up against the wall. And Don said, whoa, that's pretty good. And then right then and there, he said, he asked us, are you guys signed to anybody? And each of the guys said, not me, bass. Not me, Sammy, you know. And I had to raise my hand and said, I am. He said, well, who are you signed to? I said, Roulette Records, Morris Levy. And he said, oh, my gosh. You're like this. Look, I'll call you guys later, man. I'll see you. Just go home. 3 or 4 days later, they called us to come back to the studio, to his office. And when he sat there in his little chair, he just held up a paper. He said, I got your contract. Wow. And Morris Levy. Nobody goes away from Morris Levy. Tommy James was telling me they threw him out the office when he tried to get released. Mm-hmm. I said, well, I'm in good company, because he showed me the way that there were two big guys when I asked for a release. He was just one of those kind of really bad people.
Mm-hmm.
And he said, I got it. And I'm so glad to be, you mean, we're going to actually get to record in your record label? Yeah.
Wow.
And so I was very excited. But a few months later, I was up in Nyack, New York at Teddy Randazzo's place. Beautiful home up there overlooking the Hudson, man. And he was just talking. And I said, Teddy, I said, "You really bothered me, man. What? How did Don get that contract?" He said, "You didn't know.
That's right.
Told you." I said, "No." He said, "He put in a call to Frank Sinatra. He was the conductor and arranger and everything but Frank. Frank heard the record outside looking in because he wanted Teddy. He heard going out of my head. He wanted that song. He actually
Okay.
performed after we did.
Okay.
And he said these words, tell the kid he sings good." That was all he got. Never met the man physically. I met everybody around him, all his friends, Sammy Dave, knew all them people. Never met him. Yet he was the catalyst of my study of his phrasing and how he said. Tony Orlando told me, I'm dropping names. Tony Orlando told me, "Hey man," he told me, "Hey Tony, cross your T's, dot your I's." And I said, what did that mean?" Tony said, "I really was trying to figure it out. Then I did. And then I figured it out." I said, "Oh, I know what you mean. Because if you listen to Sinatra, you can say the word, and she said, he'll say it, and she said." It that's what he meant. Complete the English language. And then the tempo and the phrasing will follow. And I'm sure Mr. Sinatra but knew there were far greater singers than him. I mean, he thought that little Jimmy Scott was one of the greatest that ever lived, and he was.
Yes, he was
But
brilliant. Yes.
he just happened to beat Sinatra, things worked out for him, you know what I mean? And but he learned it from there. I talked to Nancy Wilson and she told me, "Well, I learned phrasing from little Jimmy Scott." I said, "Wait a minute, I'm not alone. That's how everybody's kind of developing their style. I'd like to know who Aretha Franklin." I don't think she listened to anybody. She just came out saying that. But I just wonder how the other artists see that. And I'm talking to you, and you're enlightening me. What stimulated you, and what your thoughts are. So it's a wonderful thing to be in the business we're in from a creative level, you know.
Yes. Well, this is what I also want to say. You're a great singer. You've got great control. But what we don't talk about is your rhythmic sensibility, your phrasing sensibility. It's not loose and like the Frank
No,
Sinatra
from
or
Sinatra.
even Sammy Davis or all those people. They don't have the pop hit like you have because your hits are so in this rhythmic, almost like a drummer, tight that can appeal to the kids. You got us, man, because you put it in a way that's like, wait a minute, that's not old folks' music. That's the new folks' music. Your rhythmic made it for me and my whole generation and everybody. You caught us because of your rhythm, not just the voice, the rhythm. And when you would go off on the ending, it'd be badass. It'd be the new way. And we're still doing that way. Every singer we know is trying to still do what you did then.
And most equipment was improvisation. I don't know what I was doing. Like, you have the attitude. And I just said, like, even with the tears of, I don't know. I just, it felt good doing it. And all the other songs that I've done like that. I guess that was that it or whatever it is that I was doing, it caught on to it, and it really got to a lot of writers and other singers that, you know, the phrasing that came from Sinatra, man. That came from Cole. That came from them cats because now, you know, he played the piano, man. He was an ex his piano was an extension of him. I couldn't tell the difference between the piano and him. One day, man. And I used to say, "Dang, that guy's smooth. How does he do that?" I tried, but I didn't nail it, man, until I realized I'm gonna have to do this my way, the best that I can do, and go from there. There's a young man that sang with a group called the Flamingos. "I Only Have
Yes.
Eyes for You" and
Oh my
all
God, yes, of course.
"Golden Teardrops" and all that. His name was Nate Nelson. Nathan Nelson was the front man, the leader of the Flamingos. And Terry Johnson, one of the Flamingos, the tenor, and the guy that did all the music, and I talk all the time, maybe once, two times a week now. And he said personally, he thought that's one of the greatest praising guys I've ever heard. Now, most people wouldn't even know who Nate Nelson was,
right?
Because he didn't say Nate Nelson and the Flamingos.
Right, that's right.
It's Nate Nelson. But if you hear the Flamingos, especially Only Have Eyes for You,
mm-hmm.
Oh my goodness.
Yeah. You're right. You're right.
I even covered it once, me and the guys. And it was good. I mean, what we did, but I could never reach where he was.
Mm-hmm.
It just was impossible. I didn't have that what he had. And I've always said that over and over and over again to people, man, that there are a lot of singers that's gonna sing better than the other singer, maybe because of circumstances, whatever it might be, then you get the shot.
Mm-hmm.
That does not make you the best. And mm-hmm. one of the things that I've learned, I'd like to teach young people, don't ever get into that state of mind where you think, I'm bad, I'm it, I'm that, oh boy, I'm good. Yeah. No, you have to constantly think, how can I do this better?
Right.
Well, let me listen to this. I have more fun going to other shows, other singers.
Mm-hmm.
And when I'm sitting in the audience, I'm not sitting there as a fan. I'm a fan.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm dissecting what's going on with the musicians, what he's doing, and what did he just do? Like, oh, she did, you know, whoa, man, she, that was, so you never stop learning.
Mm-hmm.
You for as long as you live, that's how we're designed by God, man. You can't.
Mm-hmm.
You're a creative being whose whole thing is to create things.
Mm-hmm.
And if you get settled down and settled in, like, oh, this is cool, I have everything, one of them, I'm Harry James or whoever. No, man, I'm still scared sometimes when I go out on the stage.
Mm-hmm.
I wonder if I'll be able to hit that note. I wonder, oh, did that person over there see what I was trying to do? Mm-hmm. And I was told by other artists, that's the best thing you can have.
Right, it
Don't
is.
Be fair.
Yes.
Because it pushes you to reach further into yourself, and a lot of times you find your better self. Mm-hmm. I don't care if you're the drummer or reed man or brass cat or whatever it is. Mm-hmm. It's that feeling, I just gotta, there's more, I gotta get there, I gotta figure that out and keep that going. And I think once you lose that, then you just become, I guess, stale. I mean, mm-hmm. you become a caricature of yourself,
mm-hmm.
trying to be something you can't. I can't be little Anthony at 17 and 18 years old. It's impossible.
Mm-hmm.
But I could be the best little Anthony at 83.
Right. How did you enjoy working with Tom Bell and the Philadelphia Cats?
Man, I'm
you
so
know,
blessed, man. Oh, I worked with some of the best.
Yeah, I know.
Poppy was in Linda Creed.
Yeah, exactly.
The lyrics, yeah.
Mm-hmm.
this was a great association, not long enough.
Okay.
We would have done, we may have had the same success as Teddy and I had, the Imperials. If some politics got into it with the AFCO Embassy Records, as I remembered, and Hugo and Luigi were the cats that ran it, and there was a dispute between Don Taylor, who was our manager, who was Bob Marley's manager as well. That's another story. But he there was some kind of a feud, and it caused Tommy to want to back out of not us, but of that situation with the record company that he felt is going to not do him well.
Okay.
So that association didn't last long, not because a lot of the songs you hear the stylistic do, mm-hmm. was written for us.
Okay.
It was written for us.
Mm-hmm.
Da-da-dee-da-dum. I sang that. I rehearsed it. We haven't. There's a collector somewhere out there. If anybody out there know who they are, please get in contact with the artist, somebody. I like to get our version of it before the stylistic did it. And when I heard Russell Thompson, I said, oh my goodness, he's following the same pattern. You know, how he sang. He had a much smoother voice, more of a falsetto sort of tenor. So he didn't really force the song. He did it very, I thought he did it great. I told him that a
Yes.
bunch of times. He did.
Yes.
But when I heard me, when I just was playing some time ago, I don't have it, but maybe one of the Imperials do, and I was just listening, I found something in there that Tommy and Linda was trying to, again, that the writer
Yes.
was trying to say.
Yes.
And I'm not saying that it was better, but there was something, how our version was how do you call it? It wasn't deeper. It was just, I think I nailed what Tommy wanted, you know.
Yes. Well, can I want to ask you another question about that. And just chord changes. You've worked with the geniuses of the Teddy Randazzo, of course, and now Tom Bell and many. But the point I'm making is these great genius writers were not afraid to use chord changes that would push and open doors and windows and to a singer like you. How did you feel handling movement of chord changes coming at you? Do they ever throw you off, or how did you feel about that?
Man, it was like a challenge sometimes because Teddy and Tommy were like in the same kind of world. Actually, Tommy said Teddy was his idol, so he learned orchestration from listening to all the records that Teddy was had arranged. And if you listen to the two, there is a similarity. And Tommy said, like Tommy would say, "Come on, man, you know." You get to go. You get stop fooling around. You can do that. And I would say, Tommy, I had a brain fart, man. I don't know what to do. And we'd work it out. Eventually, I'd get some idea and then find out the way it's easier for me to get in and get out. So there were sometimes there were challenges, especially with Teddy Randazzo, because what the stuff he was doing, it was like, really? No, I want this man and this. And I'm going, oh boy. And I just worked it out because they, as individuals, were so cool
Yes.
as directors and producers.
Yes.
They worked out the roadmap for me to follow to get there. And they would say, no, turn right here. Don't turn left, turn right. You know, and that kind of we built on that with us. And that's why I think I did that stuff with Teddy. It's rare when you get a guy. There was a marriage between actually him and I and Don Costa, because Don told me, since I work with the top people in the business, I Tony Bennett, the Frank Sinatra and everything. And he said, "Kid, I'm not putting you down, but I want to try to teach you how to sing." And I couldn't figure, I got what? You know, like he meant what he meant was, there's more here. And he said to me, he said, "You know, you're a pop singer." I said, "I am." "Yeah, you have a great knack for that."
Yes.
And I said, "Okay." And so, in that respect, we married R&B with pop.
Yes, absolutely. That's what I'm saying. You're the true king of pop.
Well, I don't know if I'm king or not. I don't know. But it's good being king, I tell you. But I think, and I've said this many times ago, many times, that the writer is really the star. We
Yes.
just all we are is the interpreter of the music that they have written already and created in their mind what they want to hear.
Yeah.
Your job is to deliver it. It's like acting. I mean, that director or that they wanted certain thing that they saw in you. You get that part. Now you got to get the color. You got to find a way to make them say, "Oh yeah, that's it. Yeah, that's right." So that's always a challenge too. That's a big challenge. So there were days when I was working with Teddy, I wanted to go home. I can't go like this because it was hard. Like he wanted. something that I was feeling, can I get there or not? And the good news is mostly I did.
Yes, always. I think also we don't talk about it, but this gospel in your background
Yes.
is something that it goes in the gumbo to really bring it home
Well,
in you.
yeah, that's the R&B part because I was raised in church, the Baptist church. My mom, sang the Nazareth Baptist gospel singers. And I go all the way back to when Sam Cooke was not known as Sam Cooke. He was with the Soul Stirrers. And he used to stay at my aunt's house. And he always called her Mrs. Miss Ford. Her name was Sarah Ford. Bunch of us lived in that little neighborhood. I lived in Brooklyn, but I hung out in Harlem a lot. And down the street was Leslie Uggams. So we knew each other as kids. We didn't know where we were going or what we were going to do. We just did what we do. That's what we do. So we just did it. And I had the great pleasure of listening to a lot of gospel singers at that time were huge. Of course, my mother would take me with her to her church concerts with her sisters. They were called the Nazareth Baptist Singers. And they tell me and my family, my aunt Sarah, who aunt Naomi who passed away, she was like the grail. She told me, your great-great-grandfather was a great singer. I said, you was? She said, yeah. He was known in the South as one of the great gospel singers. So I was influenced from number one, learning how to riff,
There it is.
all that stuff. I'm comfortable doing it, especially when I get into that situation. Because I do things on stage and people go, they go, blah, 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 blah. It'll come out in certain songs that I do and requires that, and then it will come out. So gospel is a setup for all of us. I don't care who them singers are, basically. It's really a setup for the Houstons and who came out of church. I guarantee you, Narada, 95% of them people came out of somebody's church. I'm talking black folks generally
That's
who come
right.
out of the Baptist sort of thing. There's always that. When we talk, we say, oh, yeah, I used to sing in the choir. I used to do this, and I was a part of all of that. So I guess that got in me, like you said, a better than anybody could say, like a gumbo. It all up, and here I am.
Wow, man. So beautiful, so beautiful. Prince,
Yeah.
if he was here, he's here in my spirit here. I'm looking at a picture of him.
Yeah.
He'd want to thank you as well. He was a genius at playing and doing the falsetto, and here you are again. What you put down inspired all of us.
Well,
I know he would want to thank you.
again, it didn't by circumstances, but the young man that discovered Prince, his name is sometimes my mind goes to go to sleep. Pepe Woolley out of Minnesota started him. In fact, he wrote a book that I read was really good. And Pepe, 1970, we were in Lake Tahoe at the Sahara Hotel, and Pepe came to hang. And he said, hey man, I got this kid. And Clarence said, he said, this kid is unique. And so Clarence ends up hearing him. I didn't pay attention to it all. And then I went to New York and the kid was there and he had a little guitar or whatever. And Clarence came back and told us, he said, man, I think me and there was a very well-known producer in that name is something Sylvester. I can't remember his first name, something Sylvester. And they got together and actually recorded Prince first. I mean, they had a little thing on him. And I don't know what the song was, but they did because I remember Clarence was often running to be a part of the team, the production team that worked with him. So he knew Prince knew, of course, Pepe told me, he talked about me all the time. And so I said, I gotta meet this cat. I can't see this. And but when I saw him, I went, uh-oh. There goes that it. Yeah.
You
And
see,
then
there
Starbucks.
again, it's a mixture. It's the gumbo again. He's
Yeah,
got the
because his
church,
dad,
he's got the
I believe
pop, he's
his
got the
dad was a jazz.
soul,
Yeah,
he's got rock. He's mixing everything, man.
was
He's
his
mixing
dad a
everything.
jazz cat or something? I can't remember what it was, But no one, I didn't know that he can play like 9,000 instruments too. But he was a genius. His potential at that time was potential. Just didn't nobody know. They didn't dig in. And Pepe told me when he was young, he did everything Pepe told him to do. He's very, 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 very polite and all this stuff. So eventually they got together with the syndicate, and then the syndicate, the politics fell into play, and they kind of drifted away. In fact, Pepe married his sister
Oh.
at one point, he had something like that, or niece. And so I would tell Pepe all the time, I say, man, tell Prince, I said, hello, man. Ooh, he blew me out, dude, when I saw him in this and he did that. And I always wanted to hook up with him, but he's very, very aware of me. Yeah, he was very aware of me. Just like Bruno Mars.
Yes, that's right.
Bruno's dad is named Pete Fern, is it Fernandez or Hernandez? I knew his brother in Brooklyn when he was little, hanging around with the brother, had to watch your brother, your little brother. And I didn't know, think about it. He sent me a message, a messenger, and he says, hey, man, I know you. I met you in Brooklyn. And I'm going, I don't know. There's another singer by the name of Eddie Holman.
Of course.
Right.
Of
Eddie
course.
told me they're close, they're tight in Hawaii. He said, man, you know that they know his father said, man, he said, I told him to listen to Little Anthony and listen to all these different people, and then that's how he studied. That's it. I hear him singing, I'm going, wait a minute.
Hey there,
I'm
lonely
like
girl.
young men sometimes, you know, it's like, yeah, and I'm going, whoa. And he sent me this thing in the messenger, and I didn't know who it was. I didn't want to answer it. I said, no, I don't know who this is. And then, you know, them little small parts in your message with a picture, but it's so little,
Yes.
profile. So I said, let me see. I hit the profile. And it came up, it's Bruno Mars next to his dad. I said, oh. And I start remembering his brother. And what happened was Bruno's, I think, father went in the Navy. I don't know, but he ended up in Hawaii, married his Hawaiian girl. Their baby is Bruno Mars. Well, I used to go to a place called the Outrigger in Waikiki Beach in Honolulu. And I think it's the Blue Note now. I think they turned into the Blue Note. I might be working there. So anyway, I went in there with my wife, and we're looking at the show, and this kid comes out doing Elvis impersonation. But I was Bruno Mars. I didn't know
That's right.
it. He's a kid. I'm an old man in the hill, man. I'm like a grown man. And I see this kid. Never think anything. And then when I put the dots together later on, oh crap. And even Michael, who was it? David Guest, the late David Guest, who married Liza Minnelli. And I know Liza a long time. And he told me, man, we used to. He said, me and Michael, we were kids, man. When they come to New York, because we were living in California. They moved to California, so he was their neighbor, and somehow he ended up going to New York City with him, or Michael brought him with him or something. They were two like this, and he said, we're sneaking. We used to go into the Apollo, man, and Michael just look at you. I said,
Yes.
come on, David, come on, man.
That's right.
No, then come to find out that Gordy told him, listen to these people. He played James Brown, Jackie Wilson, and myself.
That's right. That's right. That's right. You changed the
So,
world, brother. You changed the world. You
whoa.
changed the world.
Yeah, didn't try. I didn't know what I was doing, man. I'm a nappy head brother out of Fort Greene Province, Brooklyn, and might have ended up in the slammer because I was not your choir boy. I was having all kinds of problems out there in that street.
Yes.
But it was music that actually saved me from myself. I mean, like, it put me in a position to do something that I found that I really had a passion for.
Absolutely. I have to say also, in watching your body, you know, I love prize fighters. You know, as a little kid, I loved the fighters.
Yeah.
There's some connection in your body, in the way you move quickly. That's like a prize fighter, and you know what's in your face, the passion you'll show when you're feeling something and you're quick about it.
It just
it
comes
just
out.
It grabs the listener, because we see you're so quick about it. Your mind is so fast. Like a prize fighter. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Just, you know, getting in and getting.
It's like, again, maybe that's the acting part when
Okay.
before I was known as a little Anthony. I don't know.
Okay.
All I know is why I say it's supernatural. It's not natural.
Okay.
It's instinctively there, as if I know. Because when I'm in the lyric of a song,
yeah.
I'm not just singing the song, the lyric. I'm trying to tell a story.
Right.
Of what the writer was trying to tell, what he wanted the people to hear.
Right.
That's why Teddy loved it. He said, man, you are my voice. And anybody would have heard Teddy. Teddy can sing.
Oh, okay.
Group called the Three Chuckles. He can, whoa. He was an Italian stallion. I mean, this guy, I had a man crush on him. He was one of them handsome Italian cats.
Mm-hmm.
And boy, he could sing. But he said to me, no. He said, you're going to be my voice.
Got it.
I'm going, well, really?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
He said, you can do what I can't. You can,
yes.
I hear it, but I can't get it to come out here. I always end up in another place that's there.
Mm-hmm.
And to me, it's like, not what I want to hear. He said,
yes.
That's what I learned from you when you went to DuPont. I used to stand in the wings,
mm-hmm.
and I watched you as a kid then.
Mm-hmm.
And I could see that thing you had. You would go out there every night. Because those shows ran for 2 or 3 weeks every night. And you would go out and sing, Prove It Tonight. But every time he would hear it, there's another wrinkle would come in.
Mm-hmm.
I never heard that with anybody else. It's like, as if you were creating, you're seeing the lyrics differently than you saw it the other night. And I said, probably, because if something triggers me, it'll come out that way.
Mm-hmm.
Even working with Kenny, there was a part in that song, you know, and there's no words. I'm trying to say, that cat is really wanting to be cool with this chick,
mm-hmm.
you know,
mm-hmm.
to get off from where he was, man. Like, you know, I don't have no time. You know, it's just nothing. This has to happen. So when it got to that lyric, it just came out of nowhere. I didn't know I was going there. Because
mm-hmm.
when I saw the lyric, it just said, and I'm like, I'm actually the cat. And I'm going, there's no words. And he said, whoa, I got that warrior, you know.
Yes.
And I
yes.
didn't even know. He said, man, that was so cool.
Mm-hmm.
Even when at the end of the song, I was, I didn't know. I had to ad lib, you know. And I'm locked when I'm singing and thinking, I can't go with this all up again. And I said, well, what is he? In 1 billionth of a second in my mind was like, I want you to be my girl. I want you to be my girlfriend.
Yes, yes.
A simple thing like that. And he said, what? You know, like, how did you?
Mm-hmm.
I did the character he wrote.
Mm-hmm.
He did what he wanted.
Right, right, right.
He wasn't ashamed to tell her. I want you to be my girl. I mean, really, from his heart, I want you to be my girl.
Mm-hmm.
I want you to be my girlfriend.
Mm-hmm.
My granddaughter heard it the other day. I was playing here in the office.
Yeah.
And she kept making me go over and over that one part.
Mm-hmm.
And she's 11 years old.
Okay. We're speaking again of this new song that we want you all to pay attention to. It'll be out. Kenny Burke told me it'll be out, I think, April the 3rd.
Yeah.
On all the platforms, the Spotify.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so we want to have everyone look out for this new Little Anthony jam, Time Is On My Hands, Time On My Hands.
Yes.
And you sound incredible. And I'm so proud of you.
Thank you.
Possess a spiritual magic, divine, God-ordained magic.
I hate to be, dumb people don't want it, but that's, I know that. I know it ain't me.
Okay.
Yeah, I'm glad to do it with Ken. Kenny, quite a unique guy. Very persistent. and precise in the studio, you know?
Yes,
So
yes.
I had to kind of really cut off all the other notions that I had and try to concentrate on what he was seeing. I wanted to get in his dream.
Yes.
And I did my best. So hopefully
Absolutely. I have to ask you, what is it that you'd like to do next in your life as you're progressing now with the new singles coming out? What
Yeah.
do you want? What do you
Well,
feel?
I was talking to Kenny about that. We were just shooting the breeze, and there's a man by the name of, I suppose I can say this, Ed Vitica in Los Angeles, one of the prolific arrangers and scorers and stuff like that. And he worked with some of the biggest, one of the greats. I met him through doing a PBS special. One of my people who sings with my I have a lot of girl singers now. I got girl singers, but I kept one of the guys that been with me for 12 years in Imperials, Johnny Britt. He is very talented guy. Please, he's like considered the top 20 smooth jazz trumpet players. He had a
Okay.
few hits out by himself,
Okay.
and he and I have so much in common creatively that he said, "Man, I'll put the group together. I'll put all that together." Girls and everything, I'll rehearse them, I'll get it all together. And he did. So he's the one that tipped me to Ed Vitica. And of course they were doing a PBS special called The Green Book. I don't know if you're in, The Green Book is a book that black folks had back in the days of segregation.
Got it.
Tell you where you could stay, where you know, just for you when you got in those kind of towns in the South and all that kind of
Yes,
stuff.
yes.
And so this was a big success on PBS, and then they started putting music to it, and they ended up hiring him, and he was had to do a little thing, a musical rendition of The Green Book, and so Johnny had known him, and he said, "What about Little Anthony?" He says, "Yeah." He says, "He's got a great voice." He said, "But can he sing swing?" And I sing swing. I was raised on it.
Right.
My dad's a jazz musician. He played alto and tenor, but Buddy Johnson's orchestra and Eddie Johnson. That's all I heard, right? So that's a part in me. Now, moving up, you said, what is it you want to do?
Yeah.
I know it's been done by everybody, and that's what I convinced Ed about it because we're working on it now. And I think they got a nonprofit thing that we look like we're going to be doing because we had a Zoom meeting yesterday with a bunch of
Okay.
people involved. And it's somewhat of the American songbook. Because there's a, I want to, before I leave this earth, to, I know people did it, but let me have a crack at it, you
Okay.
know? I just was telling them I like to do a lot of, what was the song? The Duke helped write, co-write. I forgot, there's so many songs he did, my brain is trying to catch that one, you know? Don't do nothing until you hear from me. Do
Right.
nothing till you hear from me. And
Right.
you never will. And I heard that. And we're going to be doing that with a 32-piece orchestra, something like that.
Okay. Okay.
So the beginning of it now, we actually have a Zoom rehearsal. He's in LA and I'm here. We're going to be. He'd be playing his piano in the studio like that. He would play his piano in the studio. And then I'll have the lyrics, and we're going to do, we always do, but only by this new technology
Yes.
and start beginning. And that's one of the first songs we're going to record. So, yeah, I'd love to do that. And with me, it's not about the money. The money, that comes. That's
Yeah.
fucked me all my
Right.
life. That always, I don't, it's the art. I'm an artist. That's who I am. I'm not a doo-wop singer. I'm not a this thing. I don't know what I am. All I know is you put the music in front of me and I'm happy. I wish I can sing or had the training to attack some operas because I'm an opera fan. Right? Yeah, I've been to a lot of operas. And that's another part of me. So it was Aretha, by the way.
Yes, absolutely.
I talked to her.
Absolutely.
That's why she did that Pavarotti thing, Nocturnal, you
Yep.
know?
I saw her rehearsing in her bedroom. She
Yeah.
invited me into her bedroom to sing it for me.
Yeah.
What?
See that? Yeah.
He was into it, man.
She told me, she said, I said to you, you didn't.
Yep. Yep.
We've known each other for 10 years. Mm-hmm. And I was talking with her, man, the way I was, but we were just rapping. She said, yeah. And she said, I just felt I could do this. This was something I wanted to do.
Yeah.
That's where I'm at right now. Not. I just want to not about how much where you can be on the charts or whatever they call it today. Things have changed. Mm-hmm. That's not it. It's I want to do something that when I leave this earth, I leave a legacy to my children, my grandchildren, my great great grandchild. And this path of this is what he did, mm-hmm. and you're part of him. You're his blood. Now whatever you do, whether you want to be this or that, or I don't, that doesn't matter. You don't be a singer. Mm-hmm. But what it takes to do something, this is what he did at a very late age in his life.
Yeah.
And it's in one case, it's frightening and exciting, if you can understand that at the same time.
Yes, yes. Well, I would love to do one more song or a few more with you as well, from my heart to your heart.
Man, you know, I said, you get out of here. He told me.
Yeah.
Oh, man, he said, Najee, the same way, yeah. Najee.
Yeah.
I didn't know cats. No, he's a big fan. I mean, you know, like to contribute to this thing. I said, whatever, man, you got it. You know, Kenny, you get, you know, because he played the song for me in his car.
Yes.
In Atlanta.
Yes.
While we were there performing, and I said, wow. Mm-hmm. The melody, it's simple lyrics. There's nothing like you deep or anything, but it was honest. And he told me because of the pandemic, I got no time to fool around.
That's right. Yeah.
So
that's you got to know, in my life, hearing hurts so bad, so powerful in my life, that we go and actually discover Teddy Randazzo. We have no idea who a Teddy Randazzo is, but because of the sound that you put together with him was so powerful, it changed our world.
Yeah,
we're still loving that kind of drama. We're still loving that kind of atmosphere.
I want so bad for him to be in the
Rock
Hall of Fame. He's already in Songwriters Hall of Fame because they got me to present that to him posthumously.
Okay. Congratulations.
We did that like 2008. He had passed since 2004. Mm-hmm. So that was like he was my brother. He was not just the producer. We were brothers. I knew everything about him. His loves, his failures, his hopes, his dreams. We would just talk. Mm-hmm. So I knew everything about him. So I guess doing his songs was a labor of love because I knew who he was. If you listen, I'm on the outside looking in. That's his wife that he lived in Las Vegas with.
Okay.
And he wanted to get back with her. He fell badly in love with her, he told me. And she wouldn't, I don't know, whatever. And he said, he won't go out of my head. Then he tried again to get her and she rejected him. He said, hurt so bad.
Oh, yeah.
That's how he wrote. He wrote what was inside of him. Mm-hmm. And then he said, take me back.
Yes.
And I'm on the outside looking in.
Yes.
It's exactly what he did in his real life. He put it in that lyric, in those songs. Mm-hmm. He heard something in me way back when I was at DuPont. Said, that's why he said, you're going to be my voice. And I could never forget. And that's what he meant.
That's right. Okay. Well, you are his voice, and you've been the voice for many of us.
Thank you, sir. Just
inspiring us. And I have and coming through. Who wants to say hello in my heart to you? Is Preston Glass?
Hey, Preston, yes, my boy.
He loves you.
I love him too, man.
He helped me so much in my work here in the studio, and so we're all being connected here. You know.
Preston. George Benson. George Benson, the guy, more than 100 million years. I bet he don't want to talk about it. But, one of his best friends, Richie.
Yeah.
Down in Pittsburgh, used to be with a group called the Marcells.
All right.
And when I met him, he was just more of a jazz playing cat. He wasn't thinking about the pop thing in me. But I met him and over the years became friends. And he told me, he said, "I bet you I can imitate you." Said, "No, you can't. I can't even imitate myself. What are you talking about?" And he said, "Yeah, this true story. Ask Preston." And he said, I can, man." But finally, he gets the guitar and he does it. Tears of my pillow. And he hit it, nailed it. And I said, because I heard the phrasing. He had nailed the phrasing down.
Yes, okay.
And I said, "Well, Don, if you did, you did it." And he said, "You know, man," he said, "I want to do a song with you, just something." Preston wrote this song, I think, in cooperation with him. What's it called? Something together. I can't remember.
Okay.
It was. And I said, "Damn, George, man, ooh, I'd love to work with this guy." And we did it the old-fashioned way. We took a little telephone mic type thing where you could sing on each side. And this wasn't no track, so we did this, and then you said your track in, and none of that. We decided to look at each other, play off each other. So in that song, Preston was really, getting us to go a certain way. And I was at awe because I'm looking at them and saying, "I'm singing with George Benson." And he's looking at me and he's saying, "I'm singing with Lil X."
That's right. That's right. That's
So we
right.
had a lot of fun doing that, man. We
Beautiful.
really did.
I also
Electric
want
together. Electric together, yeah.
I want to I want to mention also there's a great singer, but he came up at a time when he was very inspired by you. Then he became a vocal coach. He's still a coach to this day. His name is Sal Dupree. He actually sang with one of the versions of the Duprees, and he sends his love. I
Really?
told him I was speaking with you today, and he wanted you to
Yeah.
know that he's he
I
has
thought he
pictures of you in
knows.
his in his in his in his vocal coach studio for all the kids he's teaching. So
I didn't know that.
you're there around him all the time.
Well,
So
I learned
all
all
this
them
connection's
Cherokee
coming through.
guys, man. Johnny Salvato and the original cats, man, all them cats, man, we knew each other as kids. I'm dropping names, I don't care. I know Joe Pesci before he was Joe Pesci. Joe
Okay.
used to play guitar behind me. He could sing his butt off, man.
Yeah, all right.
He was a little Jimmy Scott disciple.
Yeah, that's
So
right.
when he sings, it sounds just like little Jimmy Scott.
Wow, man.
And I met him back then before him and Frank Vincent, before he got, that was a lark how he got that part in the Raging Bull.
Okay.
He was just playing himself. But I know him all the time. And then finally I introduced him to my wife, but I did a golf tournament with him or something back some 2 years ago. And she came, I said, I kept telling her, I said, "I know that guy. Like you go to the movies?" I go, and my wife goes, "Yeah, right. I do." He comes up and we're having the reception, and Frank Vincent was sitting at the other table. I'm sitting with him and my wife and his entourage. And he comes walking in, and he does this all. I don't know why he does this. He comes in, "Billy in the house, Billy in the house." And I said, "Man, you can play all that tough guy on that screen. If you say Philly in the house one more time, this Brooklyn is going to beat the living hell out of you."
Right.
But that's those guys I know. I just went to spend a wonderful night with Frankie Valli. He was at the Hard Rock here in Florida doing a concert. And we after the show, man, we were just hugging, man, because we knew each other. I knew him back in the days of Asbury Park, man, when they were called the Four Lovers. They weren't even known as the Four Seasons. All of them got little Stevie Benz sent with Springsteen. All of us know. I mean, yeah, I just did a thing with him on Sirius Radio.
Okay.
I got my own little radio show on there, on Sirius.
Great. Good. Is it going now? Are you on? Are
Yeah,
you up
things are
now?
on. I started December of last year. And
Okay.
they went up very well. They've expanded and everything. And I tell stories behind the songs. What
Beautiful.
was the backstory? Songs or like relationships with Big Joe Turner and Laverne Baker and Ruth Brown and all these people that Bo Diddley and all these people I came up with. And when we played at Songs County, Francis, I know very well. And I'll just tell, you know, she used to Mom and Bobby Darin had a thing, you know. And I said, did we work out? And I tell the story, and actually told her, she said she loved it. She said she loved that. She said, because the way you do it, it's just very entertaining, and the storytelling thing is pretty cool. And I said, yeah, I would never divulge other things. I told Stevie Van Sant, we were doing it together.
Yeah.
Simulcast. And he said something about something. And I said, well, that's for another day. That's for another story. Mm-hmm. He said, forget it, man. Tell me now. We're on cable. We can say anything.
Right, right. Yeah. Well, it's amazing because Springsteen's on my mind talking to you. I can feel his work. You know, there's so many who just adore what you do.
Oh, yeah. All of cats, man. I knew them. Clarence used to be on tenor sax, man.
Yeah, that's right.
Known him. Oh.
In this studio, I cut his hit called You're a Friend of Mine in my room here. I love him so much. And he played sax
on Freeway of Love for Rico. He was a gentle, big guy.
Yes, absolutely.
Very loving. Absolutely. And he called me little brother. Little brother, come in. I miss it. I miss the times we would talk and, you know, I miss all that stuff. So, but we're all getting older and things change.
Yes, brother. Well, okay. Is there some message for all of us at this time you want to say? Some message you want to give us?
I love the young people, man. The talent today is just as good as it always was, man. But there's sometimes there's so much technology, it ain't worth the time of day. One of the things I was taught in singing, and I like that young people understand, it's about moments. It's moments of a moment that you created, one moment in time. And at that moment could be the thing that really defines you. Fortunately, we're in a business now. It's gotten very, you know, I'm just not going to say it, like antiseptic. It's like too clean. I mean, it's like don't lose and let other people define you as an artist. If you have a gift like that, it comes from God. You have to be true to that gift and not thinking about how rich you can get. Not saying I didn't think that way in my younger days, but I'm telling you, I learned from. If you do that, you're going to be in this business a long time.
Okay. Okay, brother. Little Anthony, we love you. We salute you. And we respect you. We look to you as someone who really showed us the way. You are the way.
Well,
whatever God has given you.
Yeah.
It's been the way for our ears and our spirits.
Well, hey.
And I have to really thank you for that, you know.
I stand on the shoulder of giants, man. Before me, wonderful singers and performers inspired me and gave me the ability to be whatever I saw myself as. So thank you, man. You know, when you hear from your peers, such as you, it always warms me, man. Get my age. That stuff is like gold. You hear it. It's delightful. And so thank you so much for having me on your show. I enjoyed every minute of it.
Thank you, Anthony. And please come and visit us here at Tarpan Studios. Come and cut one of your next smashes over here.
Yeah, I'm supposed to be. You in L.A., right?
No, we're not. We're in the Bay Area. We're in San Rafael, California.
That's right. That's what he told me. Yeah.
Yeah, so, we're not far from San Francisco, not far from Oakland.
Oh, okay.
We're over here in Marin County. Marin County.
Kenny, we're going to be doing stuff. Yep. There's no doubt about it.
Okay. Love you. Thank you.
I always mention you. Thank you, baby.
You're the best. Well, you witnessed the show. This is the great Narada Michael Walden with the wonderful genius of Little Anthony from the Imperials. I'm so knocked out to have him on the show and all the great history lessons he's sharing with us. Bless you, Little Anthony. Everybody also, make sure you check out his new single, Time on My Hands. Time on My Hands, the new jam by Little Anthony. Ow!
It's my honor to introduce to you a love song that you can feel. Little Anthony from the Imperials. It's titled Time. Time on My Hands.
No more time to play those silly games, 'cause I don't wanna lose your love. You
thank you so much for listening to our All In podcast. If you enjoy the show, please follow, like, and subscribe on our socials, YouTube, Official Narada Instagram, Official Narada, one word, and All In with Narada Michael Walden on Apple Music, Spotify, and more. Thank you so very much.